connected right along with
Thank
it.
You, Lord.
With in unity, we thrive together.
Uh-huh. Amen. So, powerful talk.
Basically, what I got from it is that we need each other.
Yes.
And Amen. That's the message. That's what basically my topic is going to be hitting home. How we all need each other to sharpen each other. How we need that love from one another. How we need just to sharpen one another. And I realize in the church, we deal with being self-dependent at the same time.
Come on.
And seeing that being self-dependent is not in God's will.
Amen. Come
on, yeah.
So basically on the road to self when we start saying that we don't need nobody.
Right. Right. Yeah.
I do need you.
Right. Say it quick.
Like, what's the one song? I need you to survive.
Amen.
I care for you. You care for me.
Yeah.
I need you. You need me.
You need me.
So, and it's true. Because I heard some girls talking this morning in the job. They were just like two hands. Blah, 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 blah. And they basically told my son, oh, I can do anything by myself. And I just bust out laughing to myself. Like,
nope.
All right, you feel like you can do anything by yourself. But
right.
when that tough time comes,
that's right.
What you going to be? You going to be right on the phone.
Say it,
trying to call somebody because now you need some help.
You need some help.
So just admit it. I need help. You need help.
That's it.
I need you. You need me.
That's it.
And that's basically where we're coming from. So if you can come with me to our base scriptures, Philippians 2nd chapter 1 through 4. And I got the New Living Translation, so it's going to read a little different. But it's the same word.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
Philippians 2, 1 through 4. Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with the mind and purpose, with the same mind and purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourself. Don't look only for your own interests, but take the interest in others too.
Mm-hmm.
So that's basically like true humility. If you could really put yourself in the back seat,
when
you got that brother and sister that really has that need, that really has that word that you have your belly for them. And at the same time, while they're going through, they might got something for you at the same time.
That's
going to help you push you even further. And just by you opening your mouth, ministering to them, that's going to help you. That's going to help you thrive even more because now you see
Amen.
That you're somebody you can impart in somebody's life.
Right.
Now you know that you in a good spot in your life where you can be a help to someone.
Amen.
And that will keep you strong.
Yeah.
And that's the biggest thing, us going through trials and tribulations. It helps us to be purged and do away with them things that God was trying to kill the whole time.
All the
so
while.
It's going to help you just stay strong in him and trust him even more.
Amen.
So I just look at it like a cake. I heard of a pastor talking about that red velvet cake.
Mm-hmm.
What'd you say?
I love red velvet cake.
Yes, sir.
I love red velvet cake. One thing about a red velvet cake. It needs a lot of ingredients.
Yes, sir.
That's right. To make it right.
It don't taste right. Say it.
Right. Red velvet cake, what it needs. It needs some butter, some milk, some eggs, some coconut,
cream,
vanilla extract.
Chocolate.
Some chocolate.
Cream cheese.
And if you really think about it, that's us.
Amen.
All those ingredients coming together.
Say it.
Blending in to make that red velvet
Say
cake.
It.
Amen.
Being there to make what God's trying to do, trying to make us one.
Because
you need all them ingredients just to make that one cake.
One cake.
And that's what he's looking for. That's what he's coming back for. One church.
Already church.
So this whole union, us coming together, is a beautiful thing.
Yes, it is.
And it connects so much because I hang with a lot of Jewish people as well.
Uh-huh.
And the guy at work, we got a phone call from one of the Jewish guys like, yeah, we're going to close down one of the synagogues and we're going to be coming together with another one.
Wow.
I'm like, wow. So
That
lets me know that we connected.
Amen.
Be together.
Amen.
And trust me, we couldn't do it with just one person. It took all of us to come together
to
make
this.
It took all of us to come together to get the Spirit of God ahead.
Amen.
It takes all that.
Glory to God.
All right, turn with me to Matthew 18, 19 through the second verse. 18, yeah, okay. I wrote the wrong thing. Let me see. Okay. But this is what helps us endure.
18.
But like I said, we need each other to sharpen each other, to help us to get to that place where God's trying to take us all at.
Amen.
And it takes corporate. It takes us to be together. It takes us to be a community.
Yeah.
And it's the only way we learn how to, like, if you ever been in the suburbs, they got like neighborhood watch.
Right.
So it's basically like the same thing.
Come
we're watching
Jesus
out for one another.
That's it.
Like that. Brother and sister slipping, you like, hey, you ain't doing right. And
this right. Is right. Gotta help
and
sister slipping.
That's when you do away with that self-dependent. Because right. That self-dependent come with an attitude as well.
Yeah. Right.
Oh, nobody can't tell me nothing. But really, they can.
Right.
Yes, they can.
But it's funny though, because it's like, you know, people have that selective time when they want to hear.
Right.
Selective time when they want to hear. They really
right.
Don't want to tell you nothing.
Say
but when they need your advice.
Say it.
Mm-hmm. Then they want you to tell you something.
Uh-huh.
So like I told, I was with the sculptor one day. Yeah, I tell him my opinion is free.
Come on.
But you're gonna have to pay for my advice.
Come on.
Right.
That's it.
Come on.
Do what you want to do.
Right.
And then got your part.
Right.
So
I like that.
Yes, so I'm gonna get paid. We're 18 and 19.
Back to 18. Let's see where I was at. Okay. There we go. I also tell you this. If two of you here agree
right.
on earth
all
concerning
right.
anything I ask my Father in heaven,
right.
He will do it.
Glory
so
to God.
That show you right there. If you solo,
right.
you might get through. That's your secret time.
Uh-huh.
Right.
But He called us for fellowship.
Right.
And if you don't understand what fellowship means,
come on.
We all do it all the time. Socialize.
Right.
Fellowship means socialize.
Socialize.
With
mm-hmm.
a Christian brother or sister.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the only time you fellowship when we come together. So that time when the word done went forth and we all chilling after and just hanging out with each other and talking, oh, that's a good time. That's
mm-hmm.
a good time that we need, because there's more ministry going on. There's more,
uh-huh.
more, you know, relating going
it's
on,
yes,
which is real for us.
It's yeah. good for us.
It's real good for us. When you see some people who be with church out there ready to go,
mm-hmm.
they need some more fellowship.
They need some more fellowship.
They need
come
more
on now. That's the truth.
Yeah.
Right.
And they probably like that with their neighbors, too.
Yeah.
Now, you know, just go in the house and shut down and turn hermit.
Look out, crop.
But fellowship, it also brings encouragement as well, too.
Yes, it does.
And I can back that up. Now, Hebrews 10:24.
That's it.
It also brings encouragement. Even then, when you're in that dark time,
that's it.
You know,
yes.
Well, you know, nobody don't know what you're going through, but at the same time, somebody do know. You just got to be open to let that person in, or just say, man, I need help. I need someone to talk to.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll be right there.
That's right.
Amen.
Hebrews 10:24-25.
I'll take your word for that one. Go ahead.
And it reads, let us think of ways to motivate one another,
uh-huh.
to act of love and good works.
Say that.
And let us not neglect our meeting together,
mm-hmm.
as some people do,
mm-hmm.
but encourage one another, especially now that the days of his return is drawing near.
Yes.
So basically, he released the command.
Mm-hmm.
He released the decree.
Say it.
Fellowship.
Mm-hmm.
Be with your brother. Talk with your brother.
Just say
open yourself up.
Mm-hmm.
I got a lot of people who I like to talk to. And definitely at the job, we got like this one corner, because I work in retail, but I don't do retail. But, you know, a lot goes on in the store, so it's this corner that is just full of Christians. And, you know, you just come over there and just sit there, talk a little bit,
uh-huh.
and it helps you throughout the day when you do something on at night. And when you continue to do that, you actually connect with that person.
Because
I was talking with my brother today, and I noticed he wasn't doing too good. I was like, how you doing today? You good? And he was like, yeah. I said, you all right? You know, because I went to the next level, so I sat and talked with him for a little minute, and I knew I felt him because I was connected with him that he wasn't doing good today, so that's why it's good to talk, because
it
helps. Like I said, it keeps you stronger. It keeps
right.
you in that position of God. It keeps you humble.
Mm-hmm.
It keeps you focused, so you don't lose your mission and stray off to the left or go to the right. So it keeps you on that straight and narrow, straight ahead. And I got another guy also that is just helping going at my barbershop. I go to the barbershop after I get my hair cut. Me and him sitting there like 20, 30 more minutes. And I hope y'all get to meet him Saturday. And he's a good guy. And he really had touched me one day. He had gave me a track. Mm-hmm. First time he cut my hair, and he gave me this track. And I was in the tougher spot then. And basically, it just told me the track that he gave me hit me so hard, I just woke up, I boo-hoo cried like a little baby. Mm-hmm. And that's what I needed. It was a breakthrough. Me just really being open and real with God. And mm-hmm. that's what we need. No matter where you're at in your position, no matter the level up here,
ain't that the truth?
You need that. You need that encouragement. Yeah. That's where it helped you keep you going. Even praying for your apostle, praying for your bishop, praying for the elder, praying for the prophet. Yeah. It's a great cause. It's a great cause, and it benefits you as well because mm-hmm. it strengthens you. Now you know how to pray for them. Now you know their needs and what they're going through. So being connected with one another is a big task, and I see God really enjoys it.
Amen.
So, all I can say is just continue to be open, be real, be friendly. Show yourself kind. You want a friend?
Amen.
Show yourself friendly.
Amen.
And it's just the word. The word is real. It's straight up. And Amen. I was just so surprised because everything I heard and listened to was just connected. And if you want to deal with your pride and feel like you can do it on your own, try it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to tell you, myself, it will not work.
It don't work.
It will not work. If you see people doing it every day, that'd be a good example. I ain't be an example.
Right.
Somebody else.
I know that's right.
Else.
That's a choice. Woo, I like that. I ain't gonna be yours.
You're trying to do it by yourself. If you listen, when you hear him talk, oh, I got this. I'm gonna do this. And just sit and watch. A few minutes later, they're gonna be the same one calling. All right, I ain't got this. I need some help.
Right.
And then you'll be stuck in the place trying to figure out doing it your way. And then I done did that. Gonna mess all kind of stuff up trying to do it my way.
Right.
I ain't in that business no more.
Amen.
Business or obeying his word and doing what he tells me to do.
Amen.
And I like how my pastor put it, the Bible. Basic instructions before
leaving.
Before
leaving.
And that's what
Amen.
It is. Straight up and down. If you obey it and apply it,
Amen.
It's going to help you succeed.
Mm-hmm. Glory.
And I just want to. Okay, yeah, I'll go there. Genesis 11, 1 through 9.
Amen.
And this is talking about the Tower of Babel. And this is a good illustration of seeing the people of God come together mm-hmm. and just do a great exploit in God. Just watch them just read the story. Read the story. Genesis 11. One through nine. At one time, all the people of the world spoke the same language and mm-hmm. used the same words. As these people migrated to the east, they found a plain in the land of Babylon and settled there. And they began to teach each other. They began saying to each other, let's make bricks and harden them with fire. So they was already in unity there. Hey, mm-hmm. let's make bricks and make them a fire. And
right.
Everybody complained, I don't want to do that. I want to use sand.
Come on.
I want to use that. Nah, that ain't going to work.
Right.
They said, okay, let's do it. This is Genesis. This is the beginning.
Right.
This is before anything else even started getting going on.
So we're capable.
Before we got self-will. In this region, bricks was used instead of stone and tar and used for mortar.
Mm-hmm.
Then said, come let us build a great city for ourselves with a tower that mm-hmm. reaches into the sky. This will make us famous and keep us from being scattered all over the world. But the Lord came down and looked in the city of the tower. And the people was building, he looked and said, the people are united, and they all speak the same language.
Mm-hmm.
After this, nothing they set out to do was impossible for them.
Mm.
Come, let us go down and confuse the people with different language. Then they won't be able to understand each other.
Mm-hmm.
And that way the Lord scattered them all over the world,
and they
stopped building the city.
Mm-hmm.
That is why the city was called Babel, because that is where that's where the Lord confused the people with the different language.
Mm-hmm.
And this way he scattered them all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like the Lord did this to like issue a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that was too easy.
Mm-hmm.
Let me bring a little strategy in here, a little confusion, see if they're gonna still come together
come on.
And come together in unity,
mm-hmm.
even with all the differences. Mm-hmm. And the biggest thing that pointed out to me, I noticed when we say hallelujah, we did it 7 times. Mm-hmm. And this verse, it was the 7th verse mm-hmm. that stood out to me. Mm-hmm. And in the 7th verse it says, hold on, it was the 6th. It was the 7th. Come let us go down and confuse the people. All right, it was the 6th. Still. Mm-hmm. And he said that nothing they go out and do, they put their mind to be impossible. Mm-hmm. So, as long as we put our mind together, mm-hmm. whatever we're trying to do, whatever plan, vision,
that's the number of men.
Whatever ministry we're trying to come for, if we come together, mm-hmm. that thing would be so powerful.
Yes. Yes.
And that's what's needed. That's why I was going to that cake. I was talking about that red velvet cake. And that's the same way with our gifts. Uh-huh. I give some pray, mm-hmm. some dance, uh-huh. some sing. Uh-huh. We don't sing. We don't sing. Some must dance. But all those gifts help because they're gonna be what? They're gonna minister to somebody.
Somebody.
They're gonna affect somebody. They're gonna be affected with something that's gonna be like, what is this? Mm-hmm. Just to even watch my cousin do that, it just touched me. And I wipe them real quick because I don't want to cry. But it touches me to watch him. to watch him do that, and watch him where he came from. Because yeah. I used to get on him. But watch him come and do it for the Lord. Now that touches me. That moves yes. me. Yes. And watching somebody else being groomed in the area, being brought up, it makes you like, you know what? I want to do that too. I want to pray like that.
Right.
One man the same like that. But I do that all in my long time. I humble myself when I sing. But that's what all those gifts from. That's the differences that he need in the church. Because if everybody was the same,
right, we'd have a mess.
It'd be a mess. Like they say, too many cheese.
Cheese. Okay. Ain't that the truth?
Too many people want to take lead. Don't nobody want to listen.
Ain't that the truth?
Nobody want to follow. And that's where you'll get in trouble at.
That's a big problem.
Church will be a mess. So
yes, it would be.
This message was a good eye opener. I think yes, this really was God, because this is fresh off the press.
All
right. I tell you, we've been busy at this moment at the Davis residence. We've been coming together trying to get everything packed up in the house before the moving day came. So mm-hmm. when it's time to move, mm-hmm. we ain't still packing stuff.
All right.
So everybody got on the same page with it. That's it worked out perfect. Everything packed. Still got a little few more things, but mm-hmm. majority of the stuff packed.
Right.
Let me tell you, the first time we move,
mm-hmm.
it wasn't unity. It wasn't the unity when we did that. It was get out the house. Okay. I got it. We moved it, but it was a lot. So that this time it was different. This time it was much different. And even with that, everything, we're coming together in that way, it benefits. If you know, our brothers and sisters, they got a financial need. You know, mm-hmm. even then, you're able to meet that need, you're able to come together, all right, what can we do for them?
Right.
All of us together,
right.
we can make something happen for somebody.
We can do
it. Really serious. That's what right. it calls you to be open, like this book. It calls
Amen.
You to be open. It calls you to, you know what? All right, I got to be real. I need that's help. Right. I need prayer.
Right. I need it.
I need food.
Right.
Sometimes you don't need prayer, you need food.
Right.
Say what you need.
Say what you need. That's right. Amen.
Because you can cover it up and nobody was like, well,
you ain't say nothing.
Yeah, preacher.
There it is. Woo! What a word. That's the truth. Say something.
Go ahead.
Just say something.
Right there. I'm
going to
dance off of that.
Just say something.
So I feel like as a church, we should pray against being self-dependent.
Amen.
You know, we should be one, that one church.
We need
washed and cleansed by His Spirit. Yes.
Amen.
Washed and cleansed by His Word. He comes back for one church.
One church.
No spot, no wrinkle.
My Lord.
No nothing.
No nothing.
That's prepared. Mm-hmm. They got their hearts ready, they consecrated. They know his will, they know what he wants, they know what he desires.
Right.
That's what they're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
And we doing that.
Amen.
Just by us taking enough faith to do this.
Thank you.
And just doing this, and our house, we got man.
Amen. Amen.
We got man. Just all this unity.
Amen.
I was just telling you, we didn't do this.
My Lord.
You know, we might have been that closed mouth. I don't think we would have been that closed mouth. We would have figured out something. but we didn't have to go out and do it our way.
Right.
That's what gets you in trouble when,
right.
when you go out and try to do your own thing.
Right.
So, by us being faithful, coming together in this way, it got a need to be met. I'm sure other needs got met. I'm sure people was touched by this.
Right.
And I was moved by it. I love this. I think this is pretty cool.
Yeah, all right.
You know, it's like you get a break.
Amen.
If you know all who in labor on Sunday morning, that's a lot.
Yes.
There's a lot that going against Sunday morning. Going
yes.
Getting the rest. So
yes,
I look at this as, you know, all right, we get to relax a little bit. Like Sunday, I'm going to be chilling.
Right.
I'm gonna come with some shorts on.
Right.
but it's like that. We are at home.
Right.
I feel comfortable when I'm around y'all. I feel like I know y'all more well. So, and that's how it's supposed to be. You're supposed to be like a family.
That's right.
Saturday, I might
even
shorts.
Bermuda shorts. He's going to the beach.
I was going to be fatigued tonight. But I know it's on Saturday. But I want to close with this prayer. And the prayer is really like a beginning of something new. That's gonna help us. And it was a prayer that Paul did in 1 Corinthians.
Mm-hmm.
14. 1 Corinthians. And when I read this prayer, I was real touched by this prayer. I'm like, this is how we should be praying for each other.
Amen.
We're praying for the kingdom of God.
Right.
When we know there's some churches that's not doing God's will, they're not doing his work.
Mm-hmm.
So we should pray this way for them.
Amen.
But the ones who are, you should also pray the same way for them, that they continue to stay this way.
Amen.
Let love be your highest goal, but you should also desire the special abilities that the Spirit gives, especially the ability to prophesy. For if you have the ability to speak tongues, you will be talking only to God, since people won't be able to understand you. You will speak by the power of the Spirit. Hold on, that's the verse.
1 Corinthians, what chapter? 14 and...
Start from the third verse. And like I said, it was just Paul, it says a prayer of thanksgiving and prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I think of you, I give thanks to my God. Whenever I pray, I make my request for all of you with joy.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. For you have been my partners in spreading the good news about Christ from the time you first heard it until now. And I am certain that God, who began the good work within you, will continue his work
mm-hmm.
until the final finish on the day when Christ Jesus returns. Mm-hmm. So it is right that I should feel as I do about all of you. For you have a special place in my heart. You share with me my special favor of God, both in my imprisonment and my defending and confirming the truth of the good news. God knows how much I love you, how much I love you and long for you, with the tender compassion of Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what this pushes us to, having an attitude for Christ. embracing his characteristics and not our own. Mm-hmm. Embracing love, embracing being tender-hearted, meek, humble, gentle, patient, kind, love, happiness, peace, self-control, all of those things, and being you know, really gentle with each other, with one another. Sometimes, mm-hmm. I know we can make each other frustrated, mm-hmm. but during them times, that's when we say, all right, like they said, what would Jesus do?
Amen.
You see, Jesus has been tested through everything, mm-hmm. and he never stepped out of character.
Amen.
And that's a challenge. It's a task. I still got some work done myself, but I'm working on it. And I want to change it.
Amen.
And that's where we start. That's where it's a good place to start, with each other.
Amen.
Charity starts at home. This is home now. We family now.
Amen.
So, you see how that kind of funky?
Right.
What would Jesus do?
Amen.
Jesus don't look like that. Come on, don't talk like that.
Right.
And that's what it makes us accountable to each other.
Amen.
Accountable to you.
Amen.
Subtitle. And I'm accountable. Amen. You see me looking some type of way? Say something to me.
Amen.
Yes, sir. You see me doing something like character? Say something to me.
Right. Amen.
Be like, you know what? You shouldn't have said that. And I'm open for criticism.
Right. Amen.
Sometimes I might not want to hear it.
That's right.
Amen.
But I take it and I eat it and I change it.
Amen.
And we should all be that way with each other.
That's right. That's right. Amen.
I love y'all. Thank you.
We love you too. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Yes, he does. Yes, he's got a way.
I know all of y'all should know that God is definitely good.
That's right.
Yes.
He is. I write a book on it. Me and my nephew have been through not nothing bad, but you know, good, bad come through to make you great.
Amen.
But, Lord, I can say,
amen.
The day my nephew called me, I was in the boat. He said, I want to come home. Do not ever make you think. You say, well, he's playing with me, or he just wants some money. He just wants some money so he can spend. I better cut me God and look. You say, God is, if he's for real, you mm-hmm. show me he's for real.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
And I said this. I say, nephew, he called me back within that. Think about an hour. Maybe an hour. I told him to call me back. I said, I'll do this. I'll go to the bus station and I'll pay for the ticket.
Mm-hmm.
I told him I paid for it and told him, well, where to go at and go get the ticket and everything. And God brought him back to
God bless you, man of God.
His wife.
God bless you.
Amen.
Man.
Because you know when you're going to heaven. You have a task, but I want to say, I always was a type of personal uncle. I gave my all on to my loved ones. Not friends, too. Sometimes you give to a friend and you say you give too much, but hey, that's what God did for us.
All right.
He gave his all in all. He gave us his
life.
So that's what we got to do. On the stuff that he was talking about, and I thank God for it. I'm glad to see God raised him up and be the man that God raised him up to be.
Amen.
And not just say him, me, and everybody else. And
yes.
All of us are family.
He's raising us
up. We grow together.
Yes, we are.
And we achieve and go farther.
It's a beautiful thing.
But up next,
amen.
We have our elder, Mary.
Glory to God.
He got a name like one of my friends in school. I ain't going to but Elder Mary, let him come on and bow on the word.
Amen. All right.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Tag team.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
First of all, give Him honor to God the Father. Give an honor to his son, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And to the Holy Spirit.
Glory to God.
It's an honor and a privilege to stand before you tonight.
Yes.
We thank God for Apostle Cooper.
Glory to God. Amen.
Saving the praise and worship. Good to look out and see none of y'all left.
Oh my goodness.
I thought all y'all were going to storm the door when I was about to say. Thank God. We give honor to Christ. We give honor to Pastor Davis and Pastor Davis again.
Amen.
Apostle Lord. We give honor to my enthusiastic heads, Apostle Cooper and Bishop Cooper. We give honor to all of the deacons, all of the ministers, all of the evangelists.
Amen.
All of the mothers, everybody, right down to the little children.
Yeah.
Yes. We thank God tonight for being here.
Yeah.
We thank God for this Fifth Sunday Union.
Yes.
And,
amen.
I was telling my wife the other night, I was saying, this thing came quick.
Yes, it did.
I think I was just preaching the other day. I'm back up again. You know? We thank God.
Amen.
For God being God.
Amen.
Amen. We just count it an honor and a privilege,
yes, it
to
is,
be in the Fifth Sunday Union.
Yes.
A lot of churches don't mess with each other.
Right. Amen.
Just don't, you know,
amen.
They're right down the street from each other, right? Uh-huh. They don't even bother with each other. Their members don't even wave.
My Lord.
Everybody come to church at the same time. Nobody even.
Wow.
Everybody going in the house.
Oh, Jesus.
But we thank God for
help the church.
Fifth Sunday Union.
Amen.
And what a theme they have, right?
Amen. Yes. Glory to God.
We thrive.
Yes.
And you, we thrive.
Glory to God.
And Prophet Delvin hit it right on the head.
Yes.
And unity,
we
thrive.
Glory to God.
By author Kate B. Wilkinson. Mm-hmm. And it says the topic is looking to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
It has made the mind of Christ, my Savior, live in me from day to day, by his love and power controlling all I do and say. May the love of Jesus fill me as the waters fill the sea. Him exalting, self-abasing, this is victory. May we run the race before us, strong and brave to face the foe, looking only unto Jesus as we onward go.
Corey.
Looking only to Jesus. Paul is writing to the Philippian people.
Mm.
He's actually writing to the Philippian church.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting to note that when Paul first went to Philippi to start this church, he was put in prison.
Mm.
He was beaten.
Mm.
He was run out of time.
Right.
Yet here he is.
Mm.
He's still in prison now. He's writing this letter from prison.
Mm.
But he's still concerned about these people.
Right.
He's still concerned. And in verse 5 he says, let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus.
Mm.
This is the mind of Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Christ was on his way to the cross. Amen. He knew this from day one.
Yeah.
Yet he was concerned about everybody.
Mm.
He still laid his life down,
Jesus,
for us.
Mm.
So reading the scripture, I shan't be before you long.
Praise the Lord.
That shan't, that's an old colloquial word. Yeah. I've been to school.
Yeah.
We've been to school. Yeah. We shan't be before you long. Yeah. But the scripture is Paul is writing this letter and he's concerned about these people.
Mm-hmm.
But in this letter, it's a good-hearted letter. It's a warm letter.
Yes, it is.
It's not like the preceding book, Corinthians,
mm-hmm,
where he really had to lash out at these people because,
yes,
they,
right,
was really messing up.
Yes, mm-hmm.
They was messing up in the church house.
Mm-hmm.
Everywhere. They were messing up everywhere. So he had to just, you know, beat them.
Yeah.
So now he's talking to the Philippian people.
Right.
He's telling them about unity. He's telling them about the mind of Christ Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
So he begins, he says, if there be therefore any consolation in Christ,
yes,
if there be any comfort in Christ, if there be any comfort in you knowing that Christ loves you, if there's any comfort in knowing that Christ is going to see you through whatever you're going through.
Okay. Yes.
He's saying if there's any consolation, if you are comforted by knowing that you're a Christian, you're a child of the Most High God, then there ought to be comfort there. We all ought to have some comfort.
Yes.
Now, we're going to go through some stuff.
Right. Yeah,
don't fear about that now. You know, don't think because I got saved, I'm on the good side. But when you get saved, the devil stopped doing whatever he was doing
right.
and came to where you were. So we have purpose in man, and the purpose was to whoop you up and bring you back to his side. But if you have any consolation in Christ, knowing that Christ is your Lord and Savior, he's already saved you. Dig this. Christ has already done the hard work.
Woo! That's it. We dig it.
Already done the hard work.
Hallelujah. Already did the hard work.
All the old prophets in the Old Testament.
My God.
Already done the hard
work. Already.
All of the apostles in the New Testament. I've already done the hard work.
The hard work, yes.
All we got to do is believe this thing.
Believe it.
God has made this thing so easy that, like Bishop said, you just got to throw yourself in here.
Right. Right.
Walk over, open the door.
Pretty much. Pretty much.
This thing is easy now. All we have to do is believe.
Yes.
That itself ought to be consolation.
Receive it.
Because Christ has done it for us.
Yes, he has.
He done everything for us. Yeah. When he was on the cross, he said, it is finished.
Glory to God.
Ain't nothing that we can do.
Right.
Even if we wanted to do something else.
Right. Ain't nothing that you could do.
It's already been done.
Yeah.
So there ought to be consolation. That's what Paul was saying.
Therefore,
any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, it ought to be comforting to understand that Christ loves us.
Yes.
That God loves us no matter what. This is an unconditional love.
Yes, it is.
Y'all understand unconditional.
No matter what.
Even if you go to hell.
No matter what.
God still loves you.
Still loves us.
Even though you're burning up in hell.
Right.
God still loves you. You did it to yourself.
You did it. You chose
you that. You did that. God still loves you. When Jesus stretched out on the cross, it was for eternity.
Yes,
right.
He never closed his arms.
Preach the word.
He's still open for you. Remember now, none of us born saved.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. He waited till we got ready to be saved. And then he invited us in.
Glory to God.
It's still here for you. So he's saying here, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit. In other words, if you got the Holy Ghost.
That's it.
If you got the Holy Spirit.
Come on.
That's right, that's right.
Then if you got any of these things, and the Holy Spirit, and if any bowels and mercies.
Oh.
That word bowels means, in ancient times, they believed that your stomach area was where your life force was.
The resting place.
That was everything.
The resting place.
Right in your stomach area.
That's it.
So this he ain't trying to be nasty. He's
right.
Being, even in your inner man.
That's
right.
It.
That's right.
What inside, you got in there?
Deep down. Inside.
It is.
And you have mercies.
Mm.
Verse 2, fulfill ye my joy. In other words, make me happy.
Make me happy. That's what he said.
You got all this other stuff. You have to have this other stuff. And if you got all this other stuff, then you make me happy.
That's right.
You make me happy. You got all of this. Fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded.
Oh.
Like-minded. Brother Delvin said that we all got to be on one accord. We got to think alike.
Like-minded.
This is what Paul is saying. We got to think alike.
Right.
That's why there's no division. There can't be division in the church.
Right.
We all have one man.
One man.
That's it. No matter what else happened, no matter what nobody else say, I'm following the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it is. So this is what Paul is saying here. Be ye like-minded, having the same love. Now he ain't talking about boy and girl love. He's talking about the love of God.
That's it.
Having the same love of God. We got to love God.
Come on.
Amen. In order to follow God.
That's it.
See, we're not going to follow somebody we don't like. That's why Jesus said that. You can't serve two masters.
That's why men ain't following him, because they don't like him. That's the truth.
And so Paul is saying that you need to be loving God.
That's right.
That's what we need to be doing. So we have to have the same love, being of one accord, of one mind.
Yeah,
come on. Say it. Simply to do the work and the will of God.
Yeah.
That's what the church is for.
Yeah.
That's why he established the church. That's why he's coming back for the church. And no longer is the church the building. Remember in the Old Testament, they went to the temple. The temple was everything.
Yes.
That's where God met them, at the tabernacle and in the temple. Now, God meets us here. So he's coming back for the one church. Mm. But listen, we all got to be one-minded.
Yes.
Or one accord. That's what he's coming back for, the one church, the people that think alike. The people that act alike.
Right.
This is who he's coming back for.
That's it.
He's not coming back for the divided people, the people that come to church on Sunday, but they don't. But on Monday, they ain't acting Christian.
Right.
He ain't coming back for them.
Right.
See, so we got to be, just like Paul says, on one accord of one man. Verse 3 says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory.
Right.
Strife.
That's it.
Anger. Bitterness.
That's it.
I'm going to do this because I know she don't like
me. Oh, my God. Wow.
I'm going to do it and make her mad.
Wow.
We do things out of anger. We do things out of spite. And this is not God-like.
It was witchcraft.
Paul said to be of one man. In verse 5, he said, let the mind of Christ be in you.
That's it.
That's not Christ-like.
Come on.
So, he says, don't do nothing through strife or vainglory. That word, vainglory, is self-explanatory.
That's it.
Your glory is in vain.
There it is.
I remember now, he talked about the Pharisees, and he said they stand in the marketplace, and they do these long prayers, and they walk around with these long robes on, carrying these 16-pound Bibles.
And the mitres on the head.
Prayers, like they got a connection with God.
Right.
Jesus says, surely they have their reward.
They got it.
Their reward comes from man.
That's it.
And that's all the glory you're going to get.
That's it.
You ain't getting none from God.
That's it.
So Paul says, don't do this thing in vainglory.
That's it. That's it.
But in lowliness of man,
let
each esteem others better than themselves.
That's it.
That's kind of hard to do.
That's it.
We build each other up. How we build ourselves up.
Right.
You know, I got this and I got that.
Right.
You know, I drive a Mercedes.
Wow.
I'm over here in a gated community.
Wow.
This much money. We build ourselves up.
Sales
up. Down at our brother.
My God. Wow.
The thing is, all of that stuff that you got, what you're supposed to do is look at your brother and pray for him. Bring him up.
Give him something.
Bring him up out of that thing.
Bring him up.
That's what you got to do.
That's
what Paul is saying. In unity, that's what unity is about.
Right.
You can't be unified if you up here and your brother's down there.
Ain't that the truth?
You're not in unity.
That ain't unity.
Trying to get on the same plane. Trying to get in the same area. So Paul is saying, don't do that thing. You have to be lowly,
minded. That's it.
Today, in today's society, we can see it on TV and the commercials and everything else. Everything is high-minded. Everybody has a high mind of themselves.
Right.
I'm this, I'm that.
Mm-hmm.
Like the prophet say, you know, I got this. Uh-huh. I can do this on my own.
Right. Right.
But you're headed for destruction.
You wear yourself out.
Because just like you said, you're on your way to pride.
Right.
And pride comes before the fall.
Fall.
As soon as you get that prideful thing,
right,
you might do one or two things good on your own.
That's just one or two. That's
you're
all.
Just headed for the trap.
That's the truth.
You're headed for the trap. You just fall in the ditch. That's all it is. So we have to be low-minded. We have to let each esteem other better than themselves. We got to look upon somebody because, you know, we build ourselves up not thinking that we're all sinners.
There it is.
Everybody is a sinner.
Come on.
I don't care what kind of robe you wear. I don't care what kind of hat you got on top of you.
Right,
you're a sinner.
It can touch the moon.
But if you've accepted Jesus Christ, that's the only difference.
There it is.
That's the biggest difference and the best difference. But the deal is, you still shouldn't think yourself any better
than somebody else.
That's right.
So Paul was saying
amen.
That.
Uh-huh. Amen.
You have to esteem yourself better. You have to esteem somebody else better than you.
Yourself. Yes, right. Mm-hmm.
You can't think that you're higher than anybody else.
Right.
Because that will bring pride.
Yes, it will.
It will. Mm. Remember the man and the sinner that were praying, and the Jew stood there and he said, "I'm glad I'm not like this."
Come on now.
Look at him.
Ain't that a mess?
The guy that he said was a mess, the guy wouldn't even hold his eyes up. He already knew. A sinner already knows he's a sinner.
Right. Yes,
he wouldn't even hold his eyes up. He just smote his breast and said, but God knew what he was talking about.
He knew.
And that's what we're praying to. We're praying to God. We're
praying
to another man.
That's
it. We're not praying to another person. So that's why we have to have high esteem of another person.
Yeah.
Verse 4 says, look not every man on his own things. Look at
that's
the interesting
come
that
on.
He said things.
That's it. That's it.
But we look on things.
Right.
Especially in today's society.
Good
the things
word.
That we have.
Good word.
There
good
used to
word.
Be a thing a while back that said he that has the most toys wins.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be on bumper stickers and signs and stuff like that. There used to be a slogan a few years back.
Mm-hmm.
And people still think that. They're just not saying it now, mm-hmm. but they still think that.
Right.
The more stuff I got, the
wow.
better I am.
Wow.
The better people will conceive me.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So Paul is saying, mm-hmm. don't look on your own thing.
Uh-huh.
Now that thing includes spiritual stuff too.
Right. Right.
But you know, some of us think, you know, I've been saved 20 years.
And?
This guy been saved 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
So I know more about God than he does.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which may not be true.
Right.
See, but you can't
not.
Look on that guy. You can't look down on him.
Right.
We're all saved. Because if Jesus came back today, the guy that's been saved 2 months going to be right next to you in heaven.
So lives.
See, we all going to the same heaven.
Same heaven.
So we can't look upon
mm-hmm.
the things that we have.
Mm-hmm.
But he says, but every man also on the things of others.
Right.
We have to look on where other people are.
Right.
We have to, if they're not on our level, we have to seek to bring them up.
Right.
We have to bring them up spiritually
them.
First.
Right.
And then in the natural.
Amen.
That's right.
Because see, a lot of people don't want to be helped in the natural.
Right.
There's a lot of people that want to be right
they
where
want
they
to be
are
right.
in
yeah.
the natural.
Yeah.
But we can always come up spiritually.
Right.
That we don't never have enough spiritual stuff.
Amen.
And I don't care if you think you got it, but you ain't got it.
It's your old lane.
You always gonna need some more.
Come on, Jesus.
There's always some more.
Come on.
My God.
Last verse. Let this man be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. All of this stuff that
mm-hmm.
Paul just got through saying
mm-hmm.
was in the mind of Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Christ didn't esteem himself better than anybody, yet he was the creator of the universe.
My God.
He did not say, I'm better than these people.
Right.
Matter of fact, he thought it not robbery to come and be born as a
come on, such a lowly state.
Of no reputation.
My Lord.
He didn't have no reputation.
Mm.
They knew he was coming. Remember Pharaoh told his wise men or whoever he told, he said, look in the scriptures
mm-hmm.
and find out where this baby going to be born.
Mm-hmm.
They knew he was coming, mm-hmm. but they didn't know who he was.
They didn't know.
So we have to understand that the mind of Christ Jesus meant he gave up everything.
Yes, he did.
To come and serve us.
Glory to
remember
God.
Remember, we washed the disciples' feet.
Glory to God.
What did Peter say? Peter said, uh-uh. You're going to wash my feet because you're the Messiah. And he told him, said, if I don't wash your feet, then you ain't no part of me. In other words, if you don't let me serve you,
come on.
If you don't let me save you,
that's it.
If you don't let me bless you, then you ain't no part of me.
That's it.
Which is true. People that reject Christ
my God.
Are not not really blessed.
Right.
They're not really blessed.
Right.
Because when you look at the end result, you have to look where they're going.
Right.
So we have to thank God that God saw fit